This week in Alabama, thousands are participating in the commemoration of the historic 1965 Civil Rights March from Selma to Montgomery. The goal being there to focus attention on today's voting rights, workers' rights, and immigration reform. NCLR President Janet Murguia and members of NCLR's board of directors have joined with other civil rights leaders and immigrant groups and labor unions, marking this seminal moment in our nation's civil rights struggle. Please turn your attentions once again to the screen.
March again so that the world knows that there is still a struggle here in Alabama. We are here to march. We will overcome.
We all live in the same house. We must march together and work together to make our country and make our world a better place. We can do that.
Today, we march together because we understand that we are united, we are stronger than when they try to divide us. And we understand when they try to repress our collective vote, they are taking us back to a past that does not bear repeating.
Con esta ley han sido muchas familias afectadas, familias que se han separado, gente que ha perdido sus trabajos, familias que están perdiendo sus sueños, y es por eso que estamos nosotros luchando para tratar de terminar esto.
¿Por qué está aquí usted?
Pues defendiendo mis derechos.
The fight against voter rights suppression affects Latinos and blacks, but not just the right to vote, the right to organize as workers, the right for jobs, the right to end home foreclosure discrimination. We have everything in common, and therefore our coalition is big enough to change the South. We will create a new South together.
Latinos and African Americans are going to change this country.
That's right.
And NCLR is going to help lead the way.
Yes, we will.
Yes, we will.
Si se puede.
Si se puede.
Ladies and gentlemen, Janet Murguía.
Forty-seven years ago, in response to the brutality and injustice facing the African American community, hundreds of peaceful demonstrators started a march from Selma to Montgomery, Alabama. Led by a young student leader named John Lewis and the Reverend Hosea Williams, they began their march in 1965 by trying to cross the Edmund Pettus Bridge. They were met with violence by state and local police. Many were severely beaten, including John Lewis. 2 days ago, I joined with John Lewis, now Congressman John Lewis, and other leaders and And other leaders like the Reverend Al Sharpton, Ethel Kennedy, her daughter Carrie, Eliseo Medina, Congressional Black Caucus Chair Emanuel Cleaver, and other members of Congress, to walk in the footsteps of those who made that famous march. NCLR is there in full force. We have several board members, affiliates, and staff marching even as we speak. And on Thursday and Friday, our board chair, Danny Ortega, will be speaking at Alabama's state capitol in Montgomery. And I'm excited that so many of our sister Hispanic organizations will also be participating. Tomorrow, LULAC, LACLA, Hispanic Federation, and others will be leading a bus caravan to Alabama. We all march. We all march not only to honor the courage of those civil rights heroes on that bridge, but to fight against the injustices we face in our country today, particularly in the state of Alabama. Injustices like a new voter ID law that is actually a way to suppress minority participation in our elections. Injustices like Alabama's HB 56, that is perhaps the greatest challenge to civil rights since 1965. This bill institutes the harshest and most extreme profiling law in the country. It turns school teachers into immigration agents by requiring them to ask students and their parents about their status. As a result, our families are living in fear, and thousands of kids have vanished from the classrooms. How can you justify forcing 8-year-olds out of school? How can you justify terrorizing your neighbors and their families? How can ripping apart communities be good public policy? Proponents of these laws say they're only trying to uphold the law. But you and I know what this is really about. And if you ask Congressman Lewis, he knows what this is about too. We've been down this road before. It's about folks who have a problem with people who look like you and me raising our voices and voting in numbers greater than ever. Voter suppression laws and anti-immigrant laws are their way of trying to turn back the clock. We can't let that happen. Who would have thought that nearly 50 years after the Civil Rights Act, we would still be fighting and marching for the fundamental right of our children to be educated? That's what's happening. Who would have thought that nearly 50 years after the Voting Rights Act, that we would still be fighting and marching for the right to vote? HB 56 and voter suppression laws will undo decades of civil rights work and harken back to a dark time in history that does not bear repeating. The silver lining may be the unity we find among African Americans, Latinos, and other communities of color. And while our communities may have different journeys, we are now facing many of the same struggles. The Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. knew the importance and power of unity. In the 1960s, at the height of Cesar Chavez's fast to bring attention to the plight of farm workers, Dr. King sent him a telegram. It said, "Our separate struggles are really one, a struggle for freedom, for dignity, and humanity." That's still true today. We are so grateful for the support we have received from African-American elected officials, clergy, and community leaders. They have made a real difference and given hope to a community under siege. But ultimately, our community is responsible for our own destiny. We need to define ourselves. We have the tools, we have the resources, and we have the will to succeed. We're the largest and fastest growing consumer market in the country. Latinos hold over $1 trillion in spending power. That's $1 trillion. Imagine the clout that represents. We've seen it. When Arizona passed the now infamous profiling law, SB 1070, NCLR and other organizations led the call for a national boycott. Boycotts aren't easy, and frankly, we don't do them that often. But this time we did, at a time when their economy could ill afford an adverse economic event, Arizona lost millions and gave itself a black eye. After a year of public and economic pressure, good people in the community came to their senses. Business leaders, church leaders, and community organizers, Republicans and Democrats, worked together to push back. And we ultimately recalled the bill's chief architect, Senate President Russell Pierce. We can do this. Economic clout works. Political clout works too. According to the new census, one out of every four American citizens under the age of 18 is Hispanic. Those numbers speak for themselves. We are America's future. Yet how that future unfolds, how quickly it is realized, is in large part up to us. I don't know about you, but I don't want to wait two generations for that future. I don't want to wait for the inevitable demographic tide to bring our community to shore. I want to embrace that future now. We need to accelerate the process and galvanize our community to fully engage in its civic potential. We need to naturalize, register, mobilize, run for office, and vote at every level of community life. That's why NCLR has become one of the largest Latino voter registration organizations in the country. We need to do this now. Our plan is to register and educate voters, develop grassroots leaders, and get voters to the polls this November and beyond. We will ensure that our community is engaged every day, not just on election day. By growing the Latino vote and increasing our political influence, not only can we change public policy affecting the Latino community, we can determine our own destiny. Our community is ready. I remember meeting a brother and sister in Alabama, Ana and Sebastian, who originally came from Mexico to work in a poultry plant in a small town in Alabama called Albertville. When I learned that they had gotten up before dawn, driven 3 hours to be at this event, I thanked them for participating, and I asked him, "Why did you come?" Ana looked at me, and without hesitation, she said, "Es nuestra responsabilidad." It's our responsibility. They did not want or expect gratitude. They recognized that it was their responsibility to stand up for our community and for themselves. How can we do less? Latinos have counted too long on others to be our champions. We need to be our own champions. Like Ana, like Ana and Sebastian, we need to stand up for ourselves. We are a community with 50 million people, and it is long past time we started acting like it. Es nuestra responsabilidad. Thank you all very much. Adelante.